trick to pitching that we use in the Founder Institute program, which I also run, and a trick that I learned back in California to make it really, really easy to get the right kind of conversations with VCs and start the right kind of conversation with venture capitalists. So here's what I thought we'd do, because we got an hour and a half. I'm going to talk about it a little bit, and then, like my other incubator, I would encourage you to pitch me. I want to hear whoever's willing to pitch me, and I'm going to be a hard ass. In the Founder Institute incubator, we are very aggressive about the fact that if you're not ready to get funded, you're out. It's kind of an anti-incubator program by design, because when you graduate from that program, we put you right in front of VC. So unlike a lot of these other programs in town that are encouraging and supportive, we're the one that says, nope, that's awful, that's terrible, that's not going to work. And so if you're willing, we'll do a little bit of that, and I'll rip you to shreds if you want. Here's the trick. Most pitches, most emails to investors, most handshakes at a meetup or over drinks, always start this way. Hey, I'm Paul O'Brien. I'm the founder and CEO of MediaTek Ventures. MediaTek Ventures is a venture development company for the media industry. We focus on innovation, particularly in Austin and throughout the rest of the world. And inevitably, whomever you're talking to, whomever you're on stage in front of, whomever you send the email to, inevitably most people go, ah, that's neat, but I really don't care. I could give a damn, right? You're not telling me anything at all that matters to me as a random individual who could and should have some interest in what you're doing no matter what it is, right? All I've told you is that I have a name, I'm the CEO and founder of something, which doesn't give you any insight to whether or not I even know what I'm doing. And I've told you the name of the company and roughly what we do, which establishes that if you don't care about that, our conversation is over, right? You have no interest in my space, and so why would we continue to talk? You've all read Start With Why, Simon Sinek's work. Highly encourage the book or the blog posts if you haven't. What I want to walk through today are the five elementary things that we learned when we were fifth graders. Who, what, when, where, why. That's how to pitch. That's the trick. And it's a trick because most founders, most startups, never actually do this homework. And I actually invited my partner in MediaTek Ventures, John Tesoro. Say hi, John. John Tesoro to listen to this because, frankly, we've not done this homework either for our company. So I thought we'd kind of walk through this session for ourselves as I'm sharing it with you guys. Who, what, when, where, why, and how. Most founders never think about the fact that as they're talking to everybody and anybody, last night you're talking to random folks who have two or three glasses of wine in them, right? You have to talk to them as though they're 10-year-olds because they have no idea what you do in your industry. They don't give a damn, they don't care what blockchain is. We work in blockchain a little bit and I still don't really understand what it is. So I'm certain that no one else we talk to understands what that means. Right? We don't know how AI is gonna change the world. We don't know what predictive analytics might do. We really have no concept of these things, particularly when we're 10, right? And so these elementary lessons are critical as founders because the only way to talk to people is to bring it down to that level. Because not only are you going to stop listening to me when I just introduce myself and my title and the name of my company, but you're going to stop listening to me when I use buzzwords about what we do or I start using terminology that's specific to this industry and you're not familiar with that stuff, right? Most pitches fail. Most pitches in the Founder Institute program fail. That's why we work through that aggressively with folks and try to cut people out of the program if they're not capable of understanding at a very fundamental and elementary level what they're working on. Okay. So here's the trick. There are three ways in which to work through each of these. And forget pitching, forget funding for a second. Who, when, where, why? This afternoon, tomorrow, sit down with your team and do this work. Trust me, because it's one of the most valuable things you can do, in spite of the fact that we've not done it for MediaTek Ventures. There are essentially three things in each of these concepts that you should make sure your entire team is on board with. And by entire team, I mean you've gone through this with your advisors. You've gone through it with Mike and Dana. You've gone through it with the mentors that are coming in. Because these are the very, very fundamental questions that everybody should understand about what your business is doing. Okay? has nothing to do with the pitch. I just want you to do the homework. Who is the team, right? You don't care that my name is Paul O'Brien. You don't care that I'm the CEO and founder, right? What you care about is what's relevant to what we're doing, right? So in our case, my narrative as I talk about Media Tech Ventures is that I started my career at Yahoo. When Mark Cuban's broadcast.com got acquired by Yahoo, I've been working in media innovation for 25 years, right? I'm giving you something specific that lets you understand why I'm relevant to what we're talking about. But we also want to talk about the rest of the team, right? I don't care if you are the founder. I want to know that you've got a team of folks who are capable of what you're doing, okay? Customer profile. If you haven't done that yet, a very distinct customer profile. Not we can serve everybody, right? But very, very specific profile. Who is the person who makes a decision about your business, right? Do that homework. Who? That matters. And then, this is the odd one that nobody ever really thinks about. Capital in the context of sources of money, okay? Not capital in the sense of an investor or venture capitalist, unless that's your who, right? If what you need is a venture capitalist on board, I need that profile too. But there's no reason that your capital who can't be a bank, or a loan, or a convertible debt note, or an angel investor, or an incubator, right? Define from whom money comes into the business. Now here's where that gets really interesting. This can also be this. Right? You can certainly capitalize your business by way of your customers, and there's nothing wrong with doing that, but appreciate that they're two distinct things. Especially since what happens is this becomes the decision maker about whether or not they're going to do business with you. It's not necessarily who and why they're actually paying you money, right? So you want to start to create two different profiles about where the capital comes from, if that's the who in the context of capital.
Between customer and user in that regard?
Yeah, it could be. Not necessarily so explicitly in the sense that I'd say, yes, that's the way to do it, right? But it could be that, especially if you're enterprise, this is the manager that decides to use your infrastructure, this is the CFO who has to sign off on the check, right? You've got two different, very different individuals that you got to understand in order to close that business, for example. Okay? Now, what are we doing? Stick with green. What are we doing? UX, right? A demo, mock-up, show me exactly what it actually is. What does it do? Those are two very different things, right? One is functionality. This is how I'm going to engage with it. This is what it's going to accomplish for me, right? And then the other interesting one, what is the ROI? And the ROI follows that first set of questions, because the ROI is also for this. It's also for this, right? Why does the team care? What is the ROI that you personally are looking for in making an investment in what you're doing? What is the ROI that that customer is going to expect in giving you money? Well, they're expecting to get a product or a service or something back, right? So understand what that ROI is. And then, of course, hopefully it's obvious in the context of capital. How much equity are you giving up? What's the valuation? When are we going to exit, right? What is the ROI for an investor? When is a simple one. Past, present, future. Okay? Past, present, and future. Most founders never do this. And so you always get tripped up, or you always see people get tripped up when they're talking to venture capitalists and investors. When you show up and you pitch something and they say, wasn't there something like this 5 years ago? And you're like, I don't know. Maybe, right? And didn't that not work? Why are you doing the same thing? Okay? And this concept arrived at me in particular because I spent a long time in Silicon Valley. I've been in Austin for about 8 or 9 years. The first startup that I was involved with was an event startup. There are in any given year 12 different event startups in Austin because we're the event capital of the world. So everybody's trying to solve for the event space. And everybody's doing it the exact same way that we figured out how not to do it 15 years ago. Right? Nobody's looking at the past to figure out upon what are you building in order to offer what it is that you're offering right now, not what you're offering right now, right? I've got an MVP ready. I'm signing up beta customers, right? I want to know exactly what it is today, because as we start to explore the conversation about why you need capital, what the future looks like, what your next steps are after the accelerator, we also have to understand what the future looks like in your business, right? What is it that you're going to be doing in 6 months or 12 months or 18 months? What is it that the future of the industry is going to look like, right? How are things changing in the industry that's going to change what you're doing, okay? Where? Infrastructure, this one again, and then actually location, okay? Where does it actually take place? It's on the internet. It's a mobile application. It's a phone service, right? We deliver something right to your door. That's physically the infrastructure upon which we built it. It matters, right? I need to understand what kind of investments we're going to make there. What is the user experience in this case, right? Not the user experience of what it is, but the user experience in the context of where this is available, right? If the user experience is a mobile application, here I want to understand why it's a mobile application. How do you know that a mobile application is the right approach? Right, that that's the right user experience to bring to folks in the context of where they experience what you're doing. And it's important because as you go from the user experience with your product or your business or your service, I want you to start exploring where these folks are going to get at you. Right? From where is your customer, where is that decision maker going to discover this experience? On Google? On Facebook? Via emails that you push out, right? Where physically are people going to discover what you're doing? And here's another fun one, particularly in the context of investors. Explain to me why you are in Austin. Make it relevant, right? You're not doing this startup in Austin because you like Austin and you live here. No, right? Why is it that Austin is the right place for you to be given what you're doing? A good example of that, given where I come from again, you don't build a search engine in Texas. You go to Palo Alto, where everybody who knows how to build search engines has spent the last 25 years doing that kind of thing, generally speaking, right? Unless you can convince me, or indeed, unless you can convince me that it makes more sense to be here, to have a competitive advantage because of what Indeed can do in this part of the world, okay? So location, physically, where are you and why does that matter? All right, and then lastly, how it works and how it works summarizes all these things, right? What's the customer experience? What's the investor experience? How are they going to get their return, right? And then how are we going to grow the business? How are we going to compete, sustain, and develop a company, okay? Now, the reason I give you the elementary exercise, and I'm going to send to Dana or someone, I'm going to send a document that actually gets into this in a little bit more detail. Go ahead.
No why on the list.
Who won one more? Thank you. Yes, why, right? We start with why.
What were the bottom ones?
Not having how, slides. How? Who, what, when, where, why?
Investor experience.
And how.
Okay, that's what I think.
Thank you very much. Why is the team doing it? I'm going to do it in black so you can see it stand out, right? Why are you doing this? Why do you care? Because when you're pitching, when you're reaching out to an angel investor, what I want to hear is not that you found a problem solution. I want to hear that you personally give a damn about this and you're never going to quit, right? Most startups fail simply because the team gives up, period, end of discussion. Most startups fail only because you stop. So you convince me that you're not going to stop, you're going to do this forever until you make it work. You're getting a check, right? So why is the team involved? Market, right? Why does the market care? Why is it going to work in the market? Competitive analysis of the market, right? And opportunity, which ties all the stuff on the right, right? Capital, ROI, et cetera. Why there's an opportunity. Why there's an opportunity in Austin, if that's where you are. Why there's an opportunity to grow this, what the opportunity looks like in the future, okay? Now, the mistake most people make when they pitch, they pitch me this. Right? Hi, my name is Paul O'Brien. This is what we're doing. Here's how it works. Right? That's how 90% of people always start off pitching. especially if anybody's going to the A-list event tonight or one of these happy hours that we seem to have every night this week. Last night, a lot of you were probably doing it, right? You say hello to people that way. And I don't care. I don't give a damn what you're doing. I don't care how it works because I have no context yet to actually care. So what we do is we shift these. I'm going to stretch over here. It's the last one that always throws people. When? That's the perfect pitch. In a minute. Minute, right? A 60-second pitch. It's why, who, and when. And you can only do it after you've answered all these questions, right? Because part of who might be we're raising capital, right? Or we need mentors, or we're filing a grant right now with the city or the state, right? And so we need some help there. You can't keep me excited about what you're doing if I don't know anything about why it matters, what has been done in the past, what do you know about what's been done in the past, at what stage are you, right? We're already in market. We're signing up customers, so I'm ready to sign up customers, or I'm looking for partners, right? I need to know right now. And more importantly, I need to know what the future looks like. Why is this a startup? Why is there an opportunity here? And what you want to end the conversation with in a minute or less is the fact that now I'm going to ask you, rather than you telling me, I'm going to ask you these other questions. That sounds exceptional. Where do I sign up? How does it work? Right? What can I help you with? Then you know, almost unequivocally, you're getting a check when you get those kind of questions from investors, okay? And so you never want to lead with those things, because when you lead with those things, invariably what's going to happen instead is they're going to poke holes, right? I'm not quite sure how that works. Why are you doing it on an iPhone? Why aren't you doing it on Android, right? I'm going to start poking holes in it because you're trying to tell me what it is and how it works, which presupposes that you've already figured everything out. You already know the answers, right? You know how this stuff works. That's why I'm telling you. And so what am I going to do? I'm going to find holes in that because I don't believe you yet. You haven't established any credibility with me yet. You haven't explained to me why you give a damn, why we're talking to each other, right? All you're doing is introducing yourself, giving me your title, and telling me what you're doing. And I'm going to say, well, okay. Are you sure we need that? I don't think that kind of thing is fundable, right? And you get those responses from most investors. Inevitably, in a place like Austin, the kind of feedback that you get from investors is, talk to more customers, right? I'd like to hear more customers. I'd like to see more customers. You should focus on revenue. Why? Because they haven't grasped whether or not there's actually an opportunity there. They haven't grasped whether or not you've figured out whether or not there's actually an opportunity there. So their best advice to you is, you're not getting funding. Go find some customers. Right? Because they don't know what else to do with you when all you do is explain, here's what I'm doing, here's how it works. Piss off if you're not writing me a check, because I've already figured all this out. Right? No, you haven't. You haven't figured anything out. You're a startup. You've figured out what the market looks like. You've figured out what the opportunity could be. You've figured out what the team is. Hopefully, you've figured out the customers and the market. And that's what I want you to talk about in an email to an angel investor, in a handshake over a networking event. That's what I want you to talk about. Now, last neat trick. How about classically a CMO for startups? So last neat trick is that how is always the least important as a startup? Right? It's always actually the least important. It's the one thing you always want to lead with. Here's how it works. And it's always the least important as a startup. Because, right, in 6 months, you're going to pivot. You're going to figure something else out. You're going to do it a little differently. So how actually kind of torpedoes what you're doing if you lead with it, because odds are it's not correct. We know it's not correct. You like that? Okay. So here's the other neat trick from a marketing perspective, from your CMO's perspective, or from your perspective as the CEO and founder. Have you figured out a mission statement yet? Close enough. So I want you to do this homework too. homework, you think through your talking points, and then we do this. One of the most important things that your CMO or your marketing advisor should be doing is developing a very top-down marketing plan, right? Not that we're going to do AdWords or Facebook, right? But a really top-down marketing plan. How do we position the company? How do we create a culture, right? How do we figure out what our value propositions are so that we can test those things, right? That's really what the marketing person in your organization at this point where you should be doing. And there's a correlation from this to this, okay? And the correlation is that your mission statement works that way. Your philosophies as a company, as a business, work that way, okay? Here's how, right? Your mission statement is not what we're doing right now, right? Your mission statement is the most important thing you're trying to accomplish. Again, I'm a search guy, so I'm always gonna use those analogies. Google's mission statement was to index all the world's information and make it available to everybody. Right? Why? Because it's possible. Because we should. Because why not? Right? It's this big altruistic, we're going to do that because nobody else is doing it. We're going to do it for who? Well, everybody. All the information. Right? Now, if Google's mission statement was, we're building a search engine and we're going to monetize it with AdWords, and right? If it was bottoms up, everybody would start questioning that. What about videos? What about maps? Right? No. Our mission is to actually just index everything that's out there. But the philosophy is the bottoms up. Philosophy as a company, as a business, is bottoms up. We're nonprofit, we're social impact, right? How we do business, right? It's funny, no longer does Google say this. They just got a little scandal for it. Was do no evil, right? How are we gonna do this? Well, we're not gonna do anything with ill intent, right? Was their original philosophy, which has since been lost. So what's neat is, and I left these on purpose, right? So what goes in here is culture, right? Because your culture kind of stems from what it is that you're doing and where you're doing it, right? Austin's got a culture. Why are you in Austin? Because we fit into that culture. Paul, why did you leave Silicon Valley? Because they didn't really fit into the Silicon Valley culture. It was great in my 20s, it's not great anymore, right? So you see how it kind of fits into there. And then this is a really important one, your vision, right? Your vision fits somewhere above your value proposition, somewhere below your mission statement, right? And these change least most. Your value proposition can be changing weekly, can be changing daily, especially as a startup, right? Are you A/B testing? Are you multivariate testing messaging on your website? You better be. It wasn't a question. It was an encouragement, right? You're changing what it is that you're offering constantly as you figure out how to make this work. But you can't figure out what the value proposition is until you've figured out all of this stuff over here. Who are we serving? What's the ROI we're looking for? What is our team? What does our team care about? You can't figure out how to position what it is that you're offering to folks until you've done that homework and until you've figured out what it is that you guys really care about and you figured out what you're really setting out to do, right? That drives you then towards this messaging that stays on point. And it's critical to figure that stuff out on the far right-hand side, not just for the sake of investors, but for the sake of absolutely everything you're doing as a business, because the journalists want this kind of insight, right? You want really good coverage from the media. They're going to want this kind of perspective. They don't care what your product is. They don't care what your service is. They want to know why you give a damn. They want to know what it has to do with Austin or Texas, right? They want to get to know this side of things, which you can't really figure out until you figure out the left side of things. Okay? Culture and vision, by the way, change moderately, right? They're here. They change moderately. Your culture is going to evolve. Of course it is, right? As you grow the team, as you take on investors. One of the worst things you can say as a startup is, I don't want investors because I don't want to give up my company. A company, by definition, is not owned by you, right? Your culture changes as you bring on investors, as it should, because you now have other team members who simply have a vested interest in an outcome for the company. That's going to change the culture, and that's okay. If you don't want that to happen, it should be way the hell down here that I never intend to serve the capitalist investment community. I never intend to exit. I never intend to have an outcome in my business. There's nothing wrong with that, right? But what that defines immediately is don't go talk to investors, right? No problem. Figure out then where your money's going to come from. Your vision also changes modestly, right? This year, our vision to accomplish this stage that we're at. Next year, our vision to get to our Series A is going to be this instead, right? And you can't figure that out until you've done this homework for you. Okay? Make sense? Cool.
What time is it?
1:30.
2:30.
So, I didn't have anything else.
Well, can you give us an example?
So yeah, absolutely.
I get the framework, but what does that 1 minute pitch sound like?
Yep, just the top three things. And the funny thing is, I don't even have a script for my own, but here's kind of how mine works. And don't time me, because I don't even know it's a minute, right? But
why? In the past 15 years, the average creative professional, people who work in media like musicians, filmmakers, video game makers, they've been left behind because technology has outpaced their ability to keep up with the way things work. Same thing is happening on the technology side. That technology is becoming commoditized by bots, automation, robotics, outsourcing. And so technology professionals who don't have a creative skill set are also being left behind. Jack Ma in the World Economic Forum just 6 weeks ago pointed out that in the next 30 years, if we're not teaching our technology professionals creative skill sets, they will all be out of the job, every single one of them. We're addressing that particular market. I grew up in Silicon Valley. I started my career at Yahoo. My name is Paul O'Brien. I started my career at Yahoo when Mark Cuban was acquired by Yahoo and Broadcast.com. Broadcast.com was streaming media 10 years before there even was such a thing. We didn't know what we were doing with it then. And in fact, Yahoo screwed it up. We screwed it up, though, because the rest of the media industry was in New York and in LA and had no idea what Silicon Valley was doing to disrupt it. Silicon Valley was disrupting it and didn't really understand what was going on in news media, didn't really understand what was going on in Hollywood, didn't really understand what was going on in Austin's live music scene. We're working at that convergence. We're working within that history to help address the fact that in the future, these working professionals and these startup professionals who work in media technology need to understand both sides of that equation in order to move capital into that economy. That's roughly how I do it. And inevitably, right, somebody then says, well, how the hell does that work? Which is what you want, right? How do you make money? Which is what you want, right? Because now we're going to have a conversation. And generally, right, I've talked to you in a way that it doesn't shut you down because it's at least kind of interesting, right? You have something to talk about. You may not care. You may not work in the same space. And you're like, oh, that's cool. What was it like working at Yahoo, right? All you're doing in a minute or less is continuing the conversation. Right? You're not trying to close the capital. You're not trying to get me as a customer. You're certainly not trying to get me as a customer, to be clear. Right? A minute startup pitch is not a sales pitch. Right? So I don't care if your product is ready, you want me to sign up. Right? All you want me to do is go, huh, that's neat. I like it. And you sound like you know what you're talking about. So tell me more. Right? Same thing, by the way, should be done in your emails, in your LinkedIn requests, in your AngelList requests, to investors, right? When you reach out to me, I get 20 or 30 inbound emails a day, and I'm not actually a VC, from startups looking to raise capital. And 99.999% of them give me the, hey, I'm Paul, I'm raising $250,000, do you know anybody who might be interested in what we're doing? No, not at all, I got better things to do. I'm not gonna figure out your job, right? I'm not gonna figure out who might care about what you're doing when I don't even understand it yet, and I certainly don't know you yet, right? But if you open it up with, hey, this huge opportunity is here, right? And we know what we're doing, and we know who to serve, and there's a reason why we're seeking capital, and here's what that looks like in the future. The email to an investor is that open-ended. Can I just get coffee or have a conversation with you about what that might look like and whether or not we are fundable, right? I'm more willing to have that kind of conversation. But I'm not ready to just introduce you to investors or write a check based on an email alone. Okay?
Everything down here green, right, is the stuff that you want me to ask you, not the stuff that you want to tell me. Because as a startup, this can't be certain. It just can't be. You lose credibility when you pitch that information up front because it can't be certain. It's got to change, right? You're going to pivot. You're going to find a new market. You're going to find a new way to do it, as you should, right? Most startups fail because they stay focused on this stuff. They're convinced that this is what they're doing, and they never appreciate that it's the team and the people and so forth who can figure out this that matters most in order to constantly change what you're doing with those three things at the bottom. Make sense? Cool. Anybody want to go? Or you want more questions? Or you want to go?
Yeah, what's up?
Before, yeah.
You want to do it?
Yeah.
All right.
Better to go well now than when I'm in the room, right? All right. So the manufacturing and grooming industry has grown up to $21.9 billion today, and it's expected to grow 6% year over year. But that's not really what matters. What matters most are the people who support this entire economy. That's the hairdressers, your barber, your salon shop owner. And the biggest problem that I see with this entire industry is the fact that the mom and pop shop is so underserved. They don't have the financial capability or the ability to focus on social media marketing, SEO, and the exact things that get them on top of that Google search to convert a client that is not based just on local unknown traffic. And that's what we do. With Fade, we provide them with a very powerful client management suite at a significantly more competitive price range than anyone else out there. But at the same time, for their end user, we make it a really interactive experience by recommending hairstyles, products, and barbers to them to cater specifically to those needs.
Cool. You know your stuff.
Yeah.
But like I said, I'm going to rip you apart.
Go for it.
I'm going to flip that.
Uh-huh.
Entirely. Right? You led with how big the market is. You led with you know, it's a $1 billion market, and I don't even remember. I forgot what they're already.
Yeah.
Because I didn't care.
Yeah.
Right? You give me these numbers, you tell me how big it is, and I'm thinking, oh, and it's hair care stuff. I don't know anything about hair care, and I don't give a damn, obviously.
Yeah.
I wear hats because I don't know how to do my hair. So right, you shut me down before I even started to listen to you. And then your who, right in the middle, the who statement, you ended up saying we are. But your who statement right in the middle was I, right? And so my head then heard you go, this is about me, this is what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And I just shut you down even further because I was like, all right, cool, man, good luck.
Yeah.
Right? And then it was at the end there where I started to hear for the opportunity, right? And the opportunity is that, as I captured it in my head so I went wrong, right? The opportunity that I heard is that most of the small mom and pop shops, barbershops, etc., have no idea to keep how to keep up with the infrastructure to continue to drive demand for their businesses.
Yeah.
Right? So you're providing that because in the past, right, they've not had it at all. In the present, they don't have it at all. They don't have any idea what they're doing with this stuff. You're making it really easy for them to do that, right? And then I heard a bit of the we are, right, the who. So we are providing the Google, the web, whatever, all the details were, right? So backwards, I got it. Because in what you said last, what was more open-ended, is that I know a lot of people who know Google for local businesses.
Yeah.
Maybe I can get you an advisor, right? I know a lot of people who are investing in local service providers or local technology platforms. I had no idea they give a damn about hair care. But I know some people who might be interested in what you're doing from that standpoint, right? I don't know anybody who cares about your market in particular, and so you don't want to lead with the size of the market because
the white,
right? Most of us are going to get shut down,
yeah.
Right? Kind of uncommon. I'd like to hear more. You know, I'd like to hear more about who else on the team.
Okay.
Right? How do you guys know what you're doing?
Yeah.
Experiences you've had with this kind of stuff. And then, you know, try to think too in the context of what the future looks like, right? Because how it ended in 60 seconds or less, what I heard, how it ended was almost that. It was almost more like the sales pitch that I made a comment about, right? That we are doing this. Okay, great. Good luck, man. Right?
So
there's no right as a startup. There's no future requires or could look like or we're working on or you know there was less of an open opportunity for me to help you based on what the future of the market or the industry or your product or your team or your business might look like.
Yeah.
Because then it kind of ended just as a, we're doing this, right? Which is a sales pitch.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing this, and so I'm going to go, okay, cool. I hope that works, right? as opposed to giving me some sense for what the future looks like, in your case or one of the market's case, so that folks can say, ah, I could help. You need money for that, right? You're working on a mobile platform? Ah, what does that cost, right? Maybe we can help you invest in that, right? So you give me some taste of what the future is, and that's how you wrap that, right? There is no right way to close, because it depends, right? Why we do this homework. Depends on your philosophy and your culture, and whether or not you need funding, whether or not you need customers, whether or not you need partners. But you want to end it a little bit with some sort of, what's coming up is this thing that we're going to need help with.
Yeah, sure.
Cool. More? Do it.
All right, I'm going to struggle through this. I'm going to make up a completely new one. I'm not going to.
Awesome.
One.
You bet.
So there's evidence of craniotomies have been done as long as 4,000 years ago on people, and the last major advance was about 40-something years ago when they came out with MRIs. That allowed surgeons to see a 3D model of the brain to plan their surgery, but the brain moves during surgery, so the largest error in the program is due to what's called brain shift, and that is the cause of the highest risk and thousands of disabilities to patients every year. My team of biomedical engineers is led by my co-founder, a PhD optical physicist, who has invented a way to actually track changes to the shape of the brain during surgery and connect that to the patient's MRI, so we eliminate the major error in surgery.
Yeah, I quite like that. Nice job for trying something completely different.
Right,
now, I would move things around a little bit because I love the past, right?
Okay.
Because I got that. Right away, I get it. I know what you're working on. As opposed to, you know, you work in brain surgery and you do MRIs and you're a health tech thing and I don't know anything about health tech, right? I got it. Neat story that relates to what you're working on. But it was after that story where you pointed out that in your space, right, whatever it is you're solving, I'm not sure, which is kind of the point. Well, it's kind of the point because you want me to ask, right? All right, so what are you doing? But it's where it was 10, 15 seconds in where you finally said that's the leading cause of problems, whatever. And so move that up somehow, right? Nuance the beginning of that. Nuance the beginning of that because your story, your past, right? The fact that you know this stuff, I can grasp it even if I'm not a doctor, and why you care, because it's the leading cause of whatever, would be really nice up front, because then I'm going to listen. And then what you did was you explained yourself, and you told your team is, and that was fantastic, right? Same point though about future. I'm going to have questions now because I want to know more about what you're doing, but I'm not left with an understanding of what you need next, how to help. I kind of miss, maybe you
yeah,
said, I missed
it.
And so, you know, close it with that open-ended reason in which, so notice, when you close with this, what we're working on, or in the future, or I'm in need of, or right, or we're raising capital, there's no reason it couldn't end with that, but when you close with that, what you're doing is you're prompting these questions in particular, right? For what do you need mentors, right? Where, in what context, right? You need a CMO mentor, got it, okay. How is that gonna work, right? Especially if I know the industry. How is that gonna work when I know the FDA is working on whatever, right? Is working on something, blah, blah, blah. And now I'm hooked, because now you know that I understand the space and I care in a particular way, right? You want to leave that when, that last part of your pitch, in a way that I'm going
to
ask you about this.
Capital to drag this through FDA approval.
What's that?
So we're looking for mentors and capital to help us drag this through FDA approval.
Subtly, right? I would be more explicit than that because, right? I've done a lot of startup CMO stuff. And so a lot of the incubators will have folks ask me to be their marketing mentor. I don't know anything about your world, right? So you don't want me to be your marketing mentor, right? And so all I'm pointing out is that when you want to be more explicit than we're looking for mentors to help do this kind of thing, because what kind of mentors? Y'all know Jennifer Drew by any chance? She's got a tiny old startup. She's in DivInc, she's in Founders Institute. We just worked through the same question with her because she goes, I need mentors who are commercial developers of tiny homes. Like, that sounds like you need customers, right? What kind of mentors do you need in particular, right, in order to work through that? Whatever the FDA issues are that you have to figure out in order to make this work, that's what you might point out, right? I need that kind of person who has done that thing, perhaps.
I got that answer.
Yep. Yep. Okay.
Thank you.
Do
everybody's a foodie, and everybody's looking for experiences. Right? And this is creating opportunities for culinary entrepreneurs to tap into a growing market. What's happening at the same time is that as these chefs and brewers and restaurants are operating, we understand that they're good at cooking, they're putting together food, they're good at hosting, but they're not so good at marketing. So what do? We come in and we work with these culinary entrepreneurs to build up their brand and to tap into the consumer market through an experiential lens. Right? They'll put their experiences on our platform. Okay, I'm gonna start over.
Good, stand up.
Yeah. All right, I'll come up front.
Sure.
All right. So today, everybody's a foodie, and everybody's looking for an experience, right? And on the flip side, what that's creating is an opportunity for people to tap into the culinary entrepreneurship team. Chefs, restaurants, brewers, roasters, people who want to kind of build their business and also develop their brand. So what we're creating is... So yesterday I had a good, I had like a nice confidence booster, and then this kind of shifted up.
Is that a typical part of your script?
What?
Is that a typical part
it's
of your script?
It's part of it, yeah, so I all tried right. to puzzle it.
Do what we just did. Throw it all out.
Okay.
Start fresh, because here's the other trick. I know what we're doing at MediaTek Ventures so well, I could say it six different ways to Sunday.
Okay.
You never want to have a script. The reason we make everybody work through this homework is you should be able to just ramble whatever the right points are here. And not, you know, have in your head, oh, I need to say this, and I got to say that stat, and then I've got to, because you're going to screw up. Now, here's why I want you to throw it out there, because your very first point, and again, forgive me, because I said I'm going to pick on everybody.
Yeah.
Your very first point, everybody's a foodie and everybody wants culinary experiences. Yeah, so what? Right? So you're Yelp. You're opening a restaurant, right? Try to figure out in the context of mostly this,
yeah.
Right?
Okay.
Who cares?
Yeah.
Who cares? Is what you're doing for the end user? Is that why everybody's a foodie?
Right.
Or is what you're doing, right? Or is what you're doing for that chef, that independent restaurant owner, that person who wants to be, right? Is it for that market?
Okay.
And if it is, that's why you're doing, that's who you're serving.
Okay.
Right?
So, alright. So, everybody's a foodie, and everybody's seeking an experience. Right? So, whenever I'm traveling, or I'm home, I want to discover something new and different. Where do I normally find these types of events? Or destinations? I'll go to Yelp, right? I'll go to Groupon, I'll go to TripAdvisor, but I'll find the mundane experiences. So what do we create is that we empower local culinary entrepreneurs, such as chefs and restaurants, to create events that are more immersive and unique and different, to tap into that growing consumer market, to offer them something different and unique, right? So today, Omida becomes this platform, connecting the food lovers with the adventurous food lovers with the local culinary entrepreneurs who want to build up equity via brand and in a financial sense as well. So today, there's nothing centralized in that sense. So what do we see ourselves becoming? An Airbnb for the local culinary destination. To empower these chefs and restaurants to build and make money, showcase their brand, showcase their skills, but also tell their story, right? In order to paint a picture of local food culture, which allows it to amplify over time to share with other people. We're also looking for new culinary experiences. That was my iteration.
Okay, lots of what's.
Yeah.
Right, what we are is, what we're gonna do is,
yeah,
what people care about.
Okay.
I usually can't do this after one listen, but think of a bigger why. Right, and you weave in the when. Thanks to the internet and platforms like Hotels.com and Travelocity and Yelp, when people travel, they no longer find local experiences. They no longer talk to people who might know the local culture, the best places to eat, the best experiences to have in that environment, because they're getting everything booked through an engine that's just a data platform for all the local stuff.
Mm.
Most restaurants these days are chains. Most restaurants are chains, so the average person ends up eating at Chili's or McDonald's. Right? Nobody actually wants to have that experience. And the challenge is the restaurant owners, the chefs, the culinary entrepreneurs, whatever your word is, right? The who's, right? They would love to get in front of those travelers, the local foodies, the patrons who would rather support the local community, support the local culture, but those restaurateurs are focused on building a restaurant, they're focused on their art and their talent, they're focused on creating an experience for their diners. They don't really have any idea how to get what they do in front of these audiences. That's what we're doing, right? And then give me a little bit of who we are, right? In the context of past, right? What are we doing? Maybe the Airbnb piece, maybe the data piece, whatever experience you've got there, and then give it to me in the context of the future, because I didn't quite hear what the future is, right? That we are signing up beta customers right now on our mobile app, right? On a mobile app that connects a person visiting a new local environment for the first time because they're traveling to privately owned, not chain, privately owned culinary experiences that are unique to that part of the world. Right, and I use beta customers, I made it up, I use beta customers because it sets the future context that what I'm looking for from you all are other people who are really excited about that, other people who want to help with that, right? I've pointed out that I'm not yet raising funding, but I might be in the future. Set the stage for me to then say, that's brilliant. Yeah, I've had that experience. Okay. I can relate to that. You know, I was just in Ireland and didn't know where to go. I went to McDonald's, right? I can relate to it, and so now I'm going to start asking you how it works. Okay. I'm going to ask you what exactly is it, instead of you saying, here's what it is, here's how it works, and then me kind of going, I'm not so sure that's going to make sense or it's going to work.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Cool. Yeah. Thanks.
Cool.
Yeah. I'll get you guys an update soon.
Oh, yeah. All right, victims, go.
Has anyone in this room not recently watched a video? No hands? Costs a lot of money to send that video. Netflix is paying $500 million a year, so you can, oh, God knows how much YouTube is paying. We, ZPEG, a group of entrepreneurs and computer scientists, have developed a technique to reduce that cost by 20%. So our customers are probably not in this room, but it's going to be a B2B to Hulu, to YouTube, to HBO, big players. We're getting a lot of traction. We're doing pretty well. We have the thought leaders have published positive reviews of our technology. And we've partnered up with the world's largest video compression company. So now we have a warm Rolodex of interested large clients. What I need is money to pay my patent fees, my international patent fees that are coming up, possibly before I get income from licensing. So my rhetorical question is, Paul, how do I win this mass challenge and make my patent fees? Thank you very much.
That was pretty nice. The only thing I can advise is do this homework, because you know I know enough about your space that I'm left still wondering when you say Netflix and YouTube. I mean, it was a great way to present what you're doing. I'm left wondering who's actually going to decide to use this.
Uh-huh.
Right? How do we make that happen? Because that's the answer to your second question. How are we going to move this? Well, you got to convince me that you can convince them.
Uh-huh.
Right? So I need that in the pitch a little bit as uh-huh. you close. Because otherwise I hear you saying, we're doing this and we're a bunch of brilliant people and we've got to pay for the patents. So give me money.
Right. Well.
No.
Help right? me win, Matt.
Yeah.
Let me be very specific.
I have a quick suggestion though. I mean, your compression won't just affect Netflix and Hulu, right? It would have a reverse effect on us too, because we consume that data. So you could tell people that because they use your compression system, like, I have only like, 6 gigs, 10 gigs a month? And since I consume so much video,
sure.
Thank
sure.
you.
That would increase the amount of video that
that's,
I can consume.
That's absolutely right. Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
That's a great point.
That's a great point. Thank you very
much. And it's why this. Aware, right? Set of homework is important. Where is this applicable? Is it applicable to Netflix? Is that your customer? Or is it the end user? Is that your customer? Or is it Google and the fiber? Is that your customer? They want the compression stuff there? I don't know. Yeah, great point. But anyway, that was the bottom line, right? Is the close, I need to know that there's something there working in order for that win to happen. But the upfront to that was very good. All right, more. Cool. Go. All
right. So one of the dirtiest little secrets of the food industry is that we're actually more dependent now on large factory farms than we've ever been before, even though farm to table is a big thing. So my co-founder, who's an urban farmer, myself, a wholesale food buyer, developed a system to help school systems, food distributors, and grocery stores, who actually represent almost 90% of all the food that we consume, easily tap into small local farms without spending more time on the phone, which means that they can offer that farm table local product without hurting their margins. We had launched in January of this year. We have 20 users, and they're managing over 70 farms at the moment. And we're launching to expand in Texas and in across the country this summer. So we're raising a seed round right now, and we're working on expanding our sales and dev team.
Okay, generally pretty good. I still want to encourage that homework because of two things. You actually present a good opportunity for me to remind everybody not to use buzzwords. Yeah, we all kind of know what farm to table is. We do. But when you say we're in farm to table, which is a really big thing, then I'm going to go, is it? Really? I don't think I've ever sought out farm to table in particular. Maybe it is, sure. But you made me feel like I'm stupid because you know better. And you're pitching me something, and I don't quite know that I agree or know why that, right? So watch those industry references. And then, frankly, the same kind of homework. I'm thinking this homework, right? You're raising capital for sales to expand into Texas. I still don't really understand who's paying. Is it the farm? Is it the grocery store? Right? I don't know who's actually your market. I don't know who your customer is. And so I don't notice, right? And that's why I keep kind of pointing both ways. Unless we know this, we can't know this. We can't really know this, right? It's why the idea of a problem solution statement pitch is actually a very bad way to pitch. Because a problem presumes that I care about the problem.
Right.
And a solution presumes that you've solved it. So great, we're done, right? What I'd rather hear is there is this opportunity for these people that we're serving, right? And I'm not quite sure who those people are that actually care to give you money. Such that I would invest.
Would the example be right? Something like saying wholesale buyers for large food purchasers, right, have spent the same amount of time it takes to order 1,000 potatoes as it does order 100 potatoes from a local farmer. You know, something like that. So you can like envision the friction, or is it? Can I just say friction? If that's general enough business term.
I get your example. I would say that, right? It's clarifying for me who cares and who's going to use your stuff, right? And it's doing it still in a way that hopefully I'm going to say, well, how does that work? And another great example of why this is a great framework, because now when you say, I'm going to raise money, I need to raise money so I can go out throughout the rest of Texas, right? I'm thinking, why can't you do this nationally now? What if I give you $1 million instead of $250,000? Right? I'm going to start asking about how that works for that particular set of people. And is it infrastructure? Because if it's infrastructure, we can fix that, right? We can just invest in it and build more stuff. Is it salespeople all over the world? Is it market share, market awareness, right? I'm going to start asking these questions about how and what and where you're going to go. And if I'm intrigued, you're going to hear that. You're going to hear me say, why just Texas? Right? Why only 20 in Austin? Right? Why aren't you in a lot more markets already, right? Give me more of this, right? So it's clearer, clearer that there's an opportunity for that investment, right? And it's not just that I need money.
I just made this mistake today, pitching to a potential customer, so I'm really sensitive to it. But the word dirty and food in the same sentence, a little off-putting.
Go.
So after our country deinstitutionalized long-term psychiatric hospitals in the 80s, our cities, counties, and states did not fund other forms of mental health care. This led to people with mental illness landing in jails, prisons, and ERs. And in Texas, we're wasting $2.7 billion criminalizing and also trying to treat mental illness through our first responders, like fire, EMS, police departments, as well as courts, jails, and ERs. I'm a psychiatrist, and I became a psychiatrist because I lost a family member to suicide whenever I was young. Our team has deep experience in healthcare, in technology, as well as law enforcement, and we've all experienced the tragedies of untreated mental illness. So our team believes that we can prevent people who are in a mental health crisis from going to jails and ERs by intervening at the right time and the right place, through first responders, through a mobile app, and at the time of crisis. So we're looking for smart partners and investors who share in our passion for mental health, as well as criminal justice reform, to join the partnership.
I love how everybody turns around like, all right, what do you think? when the country deinstitutionalized mental health care, drop that, right? And only just drop it because you could simplify it, would allow you to get more across more quickly by not being so intentional about what formally happened. But the fact that you talked about that happening was fantastic. Right? Because I get it. I can relate. I know what you're talking about. We all know how mental health sucks in the U.S. The tail, right? I'm looking for, when you went from, we're solving this through first responders with a mobile app, you started to bleed into this, which is fine. You started to bleed into this, but you didn't give me this context.
Mm-hmm.
So I couldn't really appreciate whether or not you already had that. And that's why you were telling me, or whether or not you're working on that. And so then, when you said, I'm looking for investors and I'm looking for partners, I couldn't figure out what kind of investors or partners to put in your place. Because you kind of suggested that you already got this stuff. You got the app, suggested, right? Without really clarifying, perhaps, that you've only been beta testing this in Austin. You're developing a mobile app as we speak. It's going to be ready in 6 months, right? As opposed to giving me a little bit more of that time frame context, so that when you say I'm looking for partners, I'm looking for providers, I'm looking for investors, I can better match them, right? I can better say, okay, you need a partner in California. I get it, because that's where you're going next, right? Or you need developers to help you get the mobile app done, right? You want to set the stage that I then ask about what you're doing. Right, as opposed to it sounding like I'm already doing it, and therefore I don't need anything except your money. Why am I going to give you money? I need to know what we're.
So then it sounds like, if I framed up, we believe that we can prevent people who are in mental health crisis from going to jails and ERs. We piloted our app with the Harris County Sheriff's Office, and we got fantastic results. So now we're looking for da 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 da.
Yeah, roughly. Roughly, but actually even saying Harris County is buzzword, believe it or not, think about it, right? I have no idea where Harris County is, I don't care. Reminds me too, and I neglected this, right? You always hear the advice, and it's actually shitty advice, forgive my French. We're in a $2 billion market.
Mm-hmm.
You know why it's awful advice in the minute pitch? Because I have no idea what that means. Is that big or small? Can you get a good share of that, right? It doesn't actually tell me anything. Most startup entrepreneurs are not working in a $1 million market. Why would you bother, right? So of course you're working in a big market. So I would drop that, to point whatever it was in the beginning, I would drop that, and then at the end, we've been, yes, I love the point where we've been piloting this with, right? You fudge it a little bit. We've been piloting this with counties, various counties throughout the state.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to tell me where, I don't know. Various counties throughout the state, and I'd like to go live in 3 months with the rest of Central Texas, and we're looking for the investment and the partners that are going to help us do that. Right? Got it. Now I know. So you want local investors, you want local partners, you need... Right? Pretty good, Jennifer. I liked it.
Great
cool.
Advice.
Go.
So, in the U.S., we represent 5% of the world's population, but we use 25% of the world's resources, and we consume, or we produce, 50% of the world's waste. Now, why is that? One of the reasons why we think that is because we're a consumer culture. It's so easy to buy in the United States, and it's almost impossible to rent. Our mission at Loanables
is to reduce overconsumption by making it as easy to rent as it is to buy. Today's market has two players. There are rental companies and renters. The rental companies are fragmented. Like in Austin, there's maybe 200 event rental companies, of which maybe 10 are online where you can find inventory. So the renters have a really hard time to find inventory. And even before an event like South by Southwest, the top 10 guys were completely out of inventory. And so people were calling us to find this inventory from the other 190 companies that you couldn't find. The people that have used our service so far, we launched maybe in January, and the people that have used our service so far have loved it, saved them a ton of time, and they don't pay any extra because the rental companies are used to paying event planners a 10% of the total value, and they pay it to us without any problem. What we're looking to do is expand our model in Austin first. Right now it looks like we expand and prove. Right now it looks like we can spend about $35 to make $70. So we think that we have a good margin. And then after that, maybe towards the end of the year, we're looking to expand into additional cities. I missed the first part of your presentation, so I don't know if I missed a bunch of stuff.
No. You got your data points in there. Work on the narrative about consumption, and it was a great first 15 seconds, and I was like, all right, I got this, right? People are going to reduce waste, I get it, cool. And then you shifted drastically to renters. That's all you said, was renters. And so my head's in apartment renters, rent-a-centers, and what the hell does that have to do with waste? Right, and so I got lost a little bit. I'm trying to figure out where the connection between those two stories is. Now, here's why it matters, and here's what you did miss. Do this homework. I'm going to send a list to you. Do this homework, because what I still can't grasp then is who in the rental, community event rental space, right? I know what you're doing. Actually, I'm picking on you because of the pitch. Right? Who in the rental event rental space actually cares about the consumption and waste of stuff?
Nobody does.
So why would you lead with that, right? Because now I'm hearing that's why we're doing it. That's why I want you to invest in us. We're gonna fix that, but nobody cares, right? And that's what was in my head. Like, who cares? It's a noble ideal.
We struggle with that, and I think we recently decided that we're not gonna talk about that anymore.
Sure.
It's our internal mission, and we're mostly gonna focus on talking with the renters and the
rent. Awesome, right? So cool. I'm so glad you said that, right? Because then, so the fact that you're dealing with consumption waste stays out here, right? You might have caught that when you came in, but stays way the hell out here. How are we doing it? We're focusing on certain markets, certain verticals where there's an exceptional amount of waste.
Right.
Why? Because we care about, we, right, our mission, way at the top. Why are we doing this? Because we actually really care about that. Right? It doesn't fit in the middle of what you're talking about, right? It doesn't fit your value proposition because your actual market doesn't really give a damn, and they're not going to pay for that, right? Right. But it is a part of your mission, which helps then close investors, helps close journalists, helps close bloggers, helps close advisors who agree, who care, right? I'm like, yeah, I love that mission. I'm on board. It has nothing to do with the market, but but I would love to help you fix that, right? Let's go do that for this business that we're developing.
That's one of the big things I think we're learning from this is to not lead with our mission.
Well, that's right. So
the market doesn't care.
The catch, right? If you didn't miss it, if you did miss it, your mission is actually in this, right? Not just why. Why? Because we want to reduce consumption of waste?
Yeah.
No. Why for whom? And that's where I got lost, right? For the event renters, right? So for whom? And then I thought, well, they don't care. So that's not actually your mission, right? All you're talking about in the consumption of waste question is way, way up top. Right, your mission has to blend all this stuff together.
Yep.
Right, that in the future,
right,
when in the future we're going to accomplish this by serving these people because we care about that.
Right,
essentially. Okay. So you can keep it in there somehow, but but if you do keep it in there, make sure it
relates
to.
It's really hard to keep it in there.
I agree. I agree. It's a fun question. Send me that because I'd like to noodle that one more because it's an interesting one. Especially since in media tech, we're working with event companies quite a bit on the media side of things, so I'm a little intrigued. All right, go.
Sure.
When surgeons are scrubbed in and operating, they're cut off from the outside world. And that's because there's an intense need to stay sterile to avoid surgical site infections, and they lack a sterile user interface. And this is interfacing to things such as connecting with the patient's family, connecting with other physicians, getting their digital data like CT and MRI scans, and even getting access to the music playlists. I have been working in healthcare for the last 15 years for companies such as Target, Walgreens, and Humana, launching new businesses and launching new products into the healthcare space. My co-founder, Ashok Sitharam, is a brilliant biomedical engineer who's leading our technical development, has recently exited another startup. Let's see, we are looking for, we're looking for investors to help us to achieve clinical validation for our product and mentors to help us navigate that pathway.
Sounded too scripted. Because I'm not.
Probably because I was playing in my head.
Oh, sure, sure.
I was having trouble staying away from the what.
That's yeah. No, I can appreciate why you're having trouble with it. Because in your case, I think you do need a little more.
Yeah. We have a sterile wireless controller that helps solve this problem.
You have a sterile wireless what?
Controller. It's a mouse.
Okay.
Yeah. We're billing ourselves as the Roku of the operating room. We take regular medical grade monitors, plug in a set-top box to make it a smart monitor.
Okay.
And then we wirelessly connect our sterile controller so the surgeon can bring the wealth of information right to the fingertips.
That totally makes sense. If you totally said that, I was like, oh yeah, I got it.
Yeah. That's the one that works, but I'm talking about the product. And I was trying to stay away from that.
Yeah, no, it means your why is off just slightly. You know, maybe if you point out more, and it just gets lost in the 20 seconds of getting there. Like more specifically, what happens there that you're trying to replace, right? So it's a little clearer where you're trying to solve something. Maybe. Same thoughts. A little bit more here. Right, I think I shared it earlier. A little bit more in this case. Always be careful of saying "I" first,
okay?
Because in a 60-second pitch, when you say "I" first, people naturally tend to kind of shut down right away, because it comes across as this is my thing. This is right. I'm the inventor of. I'm the patent owner of. I'm that. You know, lead with the "we" first, right? We've had this history in the medical space, and then you can do the "I." Right, I'm this, and my co-founder is that. It's just a subtle trick so that it doesn't sound like this is only you and it's all about you. It's right. We are actually a team. We are actually a company. We're looking for help. And then a little bit more on the. More of the where and the how will work, so that it's clear what the investment is for. And that might make it a little bit more understandable with regard to why there's an opportunity and how you're solving it with what you just explained there. Thank you very much.
What if you want to say, like, a personal story for the why?
Oh, sure. There are lots of different ways to do it, right? There's no script. Right? I mean, when you heard me, I give a personal story.
Yeah.
I also give a big picture story, right? Uh-huh. Everybody's out of work. Nobody knows what they're doing.
Yeah, we have another story where we use another pitch competitions where we just tell the story of a young boy named Tyler that's being operated on and what the surgeon has to go through. And then we leave. But in a quick conversation, it wouldn't play.
Sure.
Well, what about something more along the lines of, like, there's all these great new technologies that are coming online right now that, you know, are aiding surgeons, you know, in whatever ways. One of the fundamental problems is how they can interact with that technology in a safe, sterile way. You know, something along that line that kind of gives us a sense for, like, there is a huge why, right? Which is all the stuff that we're coming up with in the biotech world that won't have any safe way of interacting with, right? Like that's, you're
yeah.
Vulnerable to that.
Yeah. And actually, it's a rather great pitch, because we're doing what you want to happen, right? Which is everybody saying, well, how does that work? but it's now making me think that I actually want to hear more, a lot more of the when work.
Okay. How did you frame that's the part I was struggling with most.
That you did it to an extent, talking about the past, right? That we've got all these devices in the surgery center and people are touching them and whatever it was, right? Okay. I remember all your talking points, but that's the past. That's the way it's been. And because of that, we have sterilization issues. Got it. That's the past. Understand. What's the present, though? And here's where I'm now pointing out that I think you need more of this window work.
Okay.
Because now I'm a little tripped up, which could be a good thing, but I think you need to address it up here. I'm a little tripped up because now I'm thinking, wouldn't I just put an Amazon Echo in my surgery center and talk to these devices?
Yeah, voice doesn't work that well in the surgical suite right now. It's on our...
I got you, but three
reasons.
Right? And so my point is, convey that, right? That actually is a valuable part of this.
Okay.
Right? So I want a little bit more of the present.
Oh, I see. So you're like, here's the tech that we're trying to...
Exactly, right? Because then I can wrap my head around better
why
there's an opportunity in the future to do what you're doing. Gotcha. And you add credibility to your story because you're pointing out that, hang on, I'm already ahead of what you're thinking. Yeah, the voice stuff doesn't work, right? And mobile devices won't work. And people are trying that stuff, but it won't work. Here's why. And so what we're doing is a wireless mouse, right? And then you can give me a little bit more of where you're testing it, where you're prototyping it, whatever. And how that then opens up the opportunity for we're seeking investment because I need to get from our prototype to our go-to-market product. I need to sign up more clinics. I need to write whatever the future is. That might be why it leaps a little, and why you need the what in there, because I'm just not hearing.
So it's okay.
It's okay
to go to the product when we hit the future part.
Yeah, right. What you want to be careful of is...
I was trying to avoid mentioning product at all.
You can certainly mention product, right? What you want to be careful of is mentioning it as though this is what we are doing. We're done. We're ready to go. We're in market.
Okay.
Right? And I'm just going to say, cool. The hell do you need investment for, man? Just go sell more of it. Right? So you want to make sure you're doing it in a time-based context, and then you're also asking in this location-based context. Right? We're only in Austin, or we're only with Seton Hospitals, and we're going right future, because that opens up the conversation to, I got it. Now I know why you need investment or partners or mentors or whatever to go to where you're going next. You don't want to be so explicit as to say this is what it is specifically, because it makes it sound like you're done, you're ready, right? We're working on, we're prototyping, right? You can get that way.
Okay,
thank you. Yeah. What about for foreign startups such as myself?
What
I found is that when I pitch into local venture capitalists over here, they have no context.
Of course.
About my market.
Yeah.
It's hard to convey the opportunity. So how would you advise?
It's why the where set of questions is very, very critical. It's why I'm a bit of an asshole in Austin, because I'm always talking about Silicon Valley investors. Because you can't pitch a local investor the same way you pitch a Silicon Valley investor, frankly. They just think completely differently. Mm-hmm. Okay? Fact. Bottom line, period. Not right or wrong, right? Any more than it's right or wrong that local investors don't understand what to do in your country, or your investors in your country agree with whether or not you've got a good idea, right? In your country, investors might think that's not a good idea because their experience there has told them it's not gonna work. Doesn't mean they're right, okay? Make sure that's clear, because that's my point about Austin versus Silicon Valley investors. Doesn't mean Silicon Valley investors are right. Doesn't mean Austin investors are right or wrong. It's just that this where set of questions about where you're doing business and why you're there and why you're in Austin and why you're not of it, right? Those are critical questions, because the experience of the capital in any of those given markets is very different, right? They're going to have a different set of expectations. They're going to have different questions. They're going to have different partners. They're going to have different history, right? Where they're either going to get it or they're not. And if you haven't studied that, then they can't connect the dots, right? They're going to raise those, I don't know anything about your country. How can I invest there? Is there a currency issue? What about the laws, right? Well, how are you launching a company here? Do you have a local entity, right? I'm going to ask you all these questions,
And so it just kind of falls apart because I have no idea how to support your business in another country. Unless, in doing this homework, you figure out the who, capital who, right? Who does understand that? That targets where you're going to start raising capital, right? You're not just going to talk to CTAM in Austin because they're probably not going to have any idea how to fund what you're doing way over there. But there's somebody in Houston, right, that does. And so there, start a conversation that way, right?
Who is important?
Who is critical? Absolutely freaking critical, right? That's why it's at the top over here, but then it's not at the top over here. You start with why, but you absolutely have to do the who as the most important thing you do. In the sense that, again, your startup will fail if this is wrong. End of discussion. I don't care if you have no money. I don't care if you have a market. None of that matters. If this is wrong, you lose every single time. Right? It's why there's such a convention out of California that people that have done startups before just get checks. Yeah. Because if they've successfully done startups before, they're the right team. I'm happy to just give them more money because I know they can do it again. Right? So you've got to understand whether you have the right team for this. Right? You've got to understand exactly who's going to buy it, who's going to make a decision about it, how you're going to go after them. And you've got to understand where the capital comes from, not necessarily a VC, right? You gotta understand exactly who the capital comes from. Maybe it's the federal government, right? Maybe it's customers, right? Maybe it's your own pocket. I'm gonna bootstrap this. Okay, why? What is the profile of you bootstrapping it, of your credit card, right? That dictates that that's the right source of capital to make this work. You gotta do that homework, because if you tell me that, no, we're gonna bootstrap this, I'm just gonna keep using my credit card, right? My head is always, as an investor, it's always immediately going to go to, great, who are all your competitors, and how fast are they going to put you out of business because you can't afford to keep up? Right? That's always the biggest problem with bootstrapping. It's not whether or not you can do it. It's whether or not somebody else can do it faster than you, right? It can outspend you. Doesn't mean you shouldn't bootstrap. The point is, you've got to do that homework and say, yep, if that's where my money is going to come from, explain to me how that makes the most sense, right? Otherwise, we're going to torpedo what you're talking about.
Should we have a different way of explaining it if we have different who in capital, or your recommendation is to just stick to one source of capital, the who, and try to pitch to it? Because for me, for example, happens the same as happens with him. In my country, the way I pitch is really different than when I come here to Austin to pitch, or I pitch to someone in Silicon Valley, because they have different experiences with capital. Is it okay, like, to change? There is, for example, I come from Puerto Rico in Latin America, it's revenue. Everyone wants more customers, more revenue. But in my experience here, people like more the big picture of it and the opportunity instead.
Here in Texas?
Yeah.
No, here in California.
Yeah.
So it does matter. It's why I stressed just do this regardless of the pitch, right? Just do this. Answer these questions in every conceivable way that you can with your team, with your advisors, with your mentors, so that everybody's on the same page about all those scenarios, right? And what's going to come out of there is, given what we're doing, given what we care about, given how we want it to work, given how this kind of stuff gets funded, right? Given all these questions, that means we have to go get money from New York. Okay, why New York? Right? Not Puerto Rico, not Austin. We gotta go to New York. Okay, fine. Why New York? Well, because they understand what we're doing, right? And the personal narrative, right, is that, yeah, California money only cares about market share. You cannot raise capital in California without a CMO on your team who has experience in the space, who knows how to get you a competitive advantage in the market so you have a sustainable, substantial market share. Period. It's how they build big disruptive companies. Because that's what they care about. That's what they focus on. Doesn't mean it's right, right? But if you're doing that, you can go sit down in Palo Alto and talk to every investor there, and they will like you. Because that's how they think, right? They think, got it. If you can get 10% of the market, I know if I give you $2 million, we'll at least have a business, right? Because you know how to get the market. Now, Texas doesn't really think that way. Frankly, it does maybe think bigger than Puerto Rico or other countries. Texas generally thinks, I want to see P&L. I want to see revenue. I want to know you've got a business here. That's not right or wrong either, right? It's just the way people think here. That's what the investors are looking for here. And so if your personal set of answers dictates that, no, man, I'm going after 50% of the market, I want to destroy the entire industry, I want to completely transform everything, get it on a freaking plane and go to California, right? If instead you've already got partners, you've already got customers, right? You want to continue to develop locally first, you don't want to go globally right away for whatever reasons, right? You figured it out. Find the investors here because they might get that, right? Or if it makes more sense to raise capital back home, right? Because they'll understand it better, or maybe they don't, right? Understand why that's the case, right? And if that's the case, they're going to be looking for what, right? And then that tells you what the future, that tells you what some of these other answers need to be, right? If that's where my money's going to come from, then my next 6 months needs to be that, not something else that I think or I hope or I want to do. No. Go solve what you need to solve in order to convince the source of capital, right? Not necessarily the investors. If it's your credit card, what do you need to do? If I'm going to bootstrap, I need revenue really fast so I can pay myself and I can pay off my debt, right? Great, fine, do that. Focus on that, right? Answer all those questions so you can figure that out and focus on the right thing. Okay? All right, one or two more. Go.
Hi guys, Jonathan Parlow from Aggressively Organic. Before I really start, I want to ask you to not believe anything I'm going to say today, but just suspend disbelief for the next 5 minutes. I encourage you to take notes because the first thing I'm going to tell you is that you can outsmart and be faster than guys like Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos. Who's the guy that's Virgin? What's his name?
Richard
Branson. Thank you. And even Larry Ellis, from co-founder of Sun Microsystems. And it's not about rockets. What we do is we build microdendritic pods. Now, what the hell is that? We can grow food, lettuce, in 16 ounces of water instead of the 3.5 gallons of water that it takes to grow it anywhere else in the world. 100% of it, by the way, per the USDA, is grown in California and Arizona. Because that's, first of all, it's a very bad strategy. My son plays Risk with his friends. The very first thing he does is takes out their damn food supply and tries to centralize it in one place, the place that's the least habitable for it to grow. He crushes it at Risk. That's what we're doing with our country right now. So I'm bringing all these up. Who are these guys? Musk, the Bezos? They just dumped every single one of them is investing in food supply chain. And they're investing heavily. $17 million for a greenhouse, $250 million for plenty. You guys, we're able to do this for less than price of a large pizza. We're able to do it more efficiently. You can take it anywhere in the world, any place that humans live. You can grow it. In this room alone, I could grow enough food to feed half of Boston. And we can do it with little infrastructure. The people in this room setting it up in about an hour, be eating in 21 days. And eating continuously. Why I brought that all together is what they're investing in. We talked about all the money, is they're investing in hydroponics. Hydroponics is cool. Start out with the horse. That's V.1. You end up with the horse and buggy. That's what they're investing in. We're the Tesla. Right now, you can get ahead of that. So what we need really is funding and support. And funding, this is what that looks like. We launched a beta campaign, beta one, August 3rd of last year. That's when we got the patents. We spent $12,219 on Facebook ads on a 100-day beta. We did $80,000 in sales, and we shut the thing down. And we just spent the last 5 months learning. Right now, we have inbound. We have entire countries. We have licensing from 12 different countries that people are working on, major retailers, major wholesalers, schools and STEM projects. We had kindergartners that grew 130 of these things as their STEM project. Turned around, gave it to a local food bank that had been harvesting off of it for 9 weeks, having kids from other schools. Kindergartners changed that entire community. We have a lot of inbound. So what we need funding for is to be the fastest out there. 20 years seems like a long time on a patent. Clock is ticking. So we need to be everywhere as quick as we can. The support side, I need a badass CMO. Not somebody that's good, not somebody that's really good. I need somebody that's really super great, that understands California, understands scale, understands global markets.
unless somebody else really wants to go, I think that was a great one to end on. Here's why. And again, I'm picking on people.
Oh, I love it. That's why I stood up here.
Your pitch was almost all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And so it came across more as a sales pitch. We're doing this. It's here. You even gave me this metric that said I only spent this much money and I got this much revenue. And then you kind of torpedo yourself and you say, but I need investment. What do you need investment for? Take your $80,000, go do more Facebook ads and turn it into $800,000, right? So because you're telling me what you're doing, you're telling me where you've been doing it, you got all these customers and these partners and all this demand all over the place, you're telling me this stuff. And since you're so passionate about the fact that it works and we're doing it, it sounds like it's ready to go. And so the entire time I'm hearing you, I'm thinking, great, I'll buy one. Let's go, right? And then you end with, but I need to secure the patent.
No, we have
that. Well, right, that's where
you didn't get that. Right?
It started to sound like, though, I need money to protect this. I need money to get a CMO. Now, here's the other reason that kind of torpedoes your pitch. Any CMO in your industry who agrees that your opportunity is substantial will come join your team without you having capital to do it, right?
I didn't know that because...
Just in the sense that if you think about it, right, the CMO's job is to build out your market share. It's the one person in your entire industry, every industry, who knows how big the opportunity is, who the customers are, how to get them, how to ensure your business works, period, right? So if your business is something that's going to work really well, you're going to find a CMO. So when you pitch that I'm raising capital because I need to get a CMO on board, okay, so what's wrong? Why isn't a CMO on board? Why don't they see what you see? Why don't they see what you want an investor to see, right? So be careful of focusing so much down here on what you're doing, where it's working, how it's working, etc. Because I'm now not really clear on what does the future really look like? You're gonna secure patents and grow? I don't know if I get that. The past was interesting, right? There's a lot of money moving into food, supply chains, food chains. That was interesting, but, it's hydroponics, right? Presently, you're working in water conservation. There's this when context that I'm missing. There's certainly a who context in the sense of who actually buys the thing. Is it a consumer thing? Is it for farms? Mm-hmm. Is it for my wife at home in the kitchen, right? I'm not sure. So I don't quite know who's gonna buy it. And the why is great in your opening, right? That these brilliant people are investing a ton of money in this stuff and we're going to conserve water in growing food, but there's no why as to why the investors would get involved. And that's why I kind of wanted to pick on you with the thought that down here, like I'm patent and CMO, nobody's gonna give you money to do that.
Yeah,
we right? Never, that's like the bare minimum of what you should
have. Yeah, we have that, right. And okay. That's right. What was missed is we have that. I mean, CMO that can take it. We have all these markets.
Yeah.
They're all inbound. I don't have reins big enough. So I have people coming in every single day, and it's like, hey, we want to do this. I have an entire country.
What is the actual issue that you have to get funding for? You can't manufacture these fast enough?
To be everywhere fast enough. So we have these it's a platform. And that's the thing, we thought we were a product to begin with. And what we found out is we're not. We have entire school systems and entire, the USDA. Coming in, we had the governor of Indiana take us to Israel and said, this is what innovation looks like in Indiana. Right now, he's there pitching. He took it. We went to India for the U.S. Department of State. This is why.
If I gave you $1 million right now, what would you do with it?
If you gave me $1 million, if you gave me $1 million right now, it would be secure the right team. I have some people, all my people are volunteering. It'd be nice to have them on payroll because they would have done forever. And then it would be marketing, and it would be continuing to file the rest of the IP. Because we have the IP on the pod that changes, it's not hydroponics, it's the next step. What we don't have is the continuation of the infrastructure. It's like, you have the IP on the car, let's go and get the IP on the gas stations.
All right.
And tires.
Send me an email too, because I like your challenge in the sense that you're stepping on your own toes.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, yeah.
If I give you $1 million, it's going to pay for people that I could already pay for if I just sold more of my stuff. I'm already selling my stuff, I just can't sell enough of it, right? So why don't you just sell more of it so you can pay people so they can figure out how to, right? So it's kind of circular, and so the investment opportunity isn't there. If I give you $1 million, I'm going to invest in the infrastructure to build X, Y, and Z, not people, not right, to build something to turn my $2 million a year business into a $20 million a year business because I can't go do, right? There's something missing in there.
Yeah,
it's not like,
well,
I'm not going to give you the money.
Yeah,
just do more what you're doing.
Yeah, so actually we'll be launching our beta 2. That's 17,813 people that signed up in the last month to buy. That launches in the next 3 days. That's revenue for that stream, the manufacturing product side, but it's not revenue for the farms side because there will be a local farm in every one commercial. That's agriculture as a service.
Got
didn't
it.
Go through the whole thing.
There's part of your answer.
There's five models, and I didn't want
right,
to
right, stage. But there's your stage, right? There's your win,
yeah.
And there's your investment opportunity. You want to stage these
right.
things, right? You've got a consumer product in market, ready to go, it's been successful. What is that? That's validation, the traction, is everything, et cetera. What we're seeing is this demand and this opportunity to go out to the farm space. I can't fund the team. It's a completely different business model, completely different infrastructure. I'm looking for $2 million to go out for that market. I've already got 10 MOUs to go fulfill that space if I can just get the funding to do it. Your investment is not at risk because I'm launching my second pilot to the consumer market right now. We're going to drive revenue that way. I want to go after this.
This is
something
all
like that.
Market. We're using this to fund the other market. This is
yeah.
why we know it's here.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
All right. I got to go.